the worldwide leader in entertainment. This is the VOC Nation Radio Network.
Hey, this is Bill DeMott, and if you think you're tough enough, you'll listen to In the Room with Brady Hicks. And if you're not tough enough, you'll listen to the Stro and Kathy. But I'm here to tell you, Hugh Morris says so, Bill DeMott says so, and if you have to answer to General Erection, he says so. In the Room with Brady Hicks. You better be listening.
All right, ladies and gentlemen, we're back and we're on the air. It's In the Room on the VOC Nation Wrestling Network on VOCNation.com. Brady Hicks here. And by the way, we're on your favorite podcast platform as well. Check them out. We're Spotify and iTunes and Stitcher and, my God, all of them. You know, all of them. Yeah, be sure to check us out. Odyssey, formerly Radio.com, iHeartRadio, all that jazz. So be sure to check us out on all those platforms. I'm Brady Hicks. With me, as always, the lovely Kathy Fitz. How you doing tonight, Kathy?
Oh, hanging in, Brady, hanging in.
Yeah, I know you've been through a rough week. It sounds like everybody has. It's kind of sucks,
yeah.
But thoughts and prayers, Kathy. Thoughts and prayers for your uncle.
Thank you.
We also have Papa Stro Maestro. How you doing, sir?
Great to be back here with you guys. I was on set most of last week, kicking out, making a comeback health-wise, so I'm ready to do this. Always highlight.
You're on the mend. Yeah,
yes.
For me too. Yeah, for sure. I was saying there's got to be something going around, so it just feels like everybody can. And I work from home, so I'm not exposed to it like I was, Kathy, you know, but it's been bad out there, so... Anyway, speaking of bad, we have Mecca Brian Johnson from Ring of Honor tonight. He's a bad guy, Kathy. He don't care for me too much, but I think we're going to have a good time anyway. 914-338-1885. So Mecca Brian Johnson. Kathy, I also talked to an old friend today. I was telling Stro off air. I was talking with Johnny Swinger today.
Really?
Yeah, I love Johnny. He's great. I told him he's my favorite part of Impact every week. I was like, hey, Daddy, you got to come on, baby. He's great. He's great. Yeah. So I'm hoping we'll be able to work that out with Impact Wrestling. We'll see. But it'd be great to have him on the air with us. And you were kind of busy this weekend, Kathy. The big event looked like a lot of great pictures.
I was up there on Saturday and... ran into an old friend, Brian Lee.
Okay.
And,
was he only there for prime time?
He's cut. Huh?
Never mind. I said, was he only there for the prime time?
Oh. Will you stop, please? And then
how did he lock up his bike? Did he have a chain? Sorry, I'm done. I'll stop. I'll be here all night. Try the fish.
Oh, please. And then the Nature Boy, Ric Flair.
Okay. All right. But what's Ric Flair up to?
The one I was more excited about, Brady.
Yeah.
Was meeting Steve Garvey.
Steve Garvey.
Oh, that's awesome.
See, I was thinking Steve Harvey. Who's Steve Garvey?
No, Garvey. Garvey.
Family Feud.
Oh. Bro?
Yes.
I'm ignoring Brady right now, Stro.
Yeah, okay.
He was awesome. 72 years old and still hot.
That's amazing. That's just amazing.
Oh, shut up, Brady.
Speaking of Flair, his uncensored podcast is this week. He's
He's making his he's making his return to the airwaves. I guess nobody's going to bring him back for a little bit. I do think he'll land on his feet. I think at some point somebody will bring him back. It's just going to take a little time, you know. But like, it seemed like he was like a sure thing to sign with AEW earlier this year, and now it's like nothing since that documentary. Speaking of Rick, speaking of Rick, did you guys hear Charlotte in that interview? She was talking about how like people give her such a hard time because she's a woman, and then she's like, "If I were a man, I'd have the biggest set of balls." I just thought it was funny. But it's amazing to me. I and so many reports kind of came out this week, Stro, about how like the four horsewomen, and in particular, I mean Charlotte and Becky, how they're just not getting along anymore. They don't even talk.
Wow.
Kind of crazy. So it's sad. It was sad to see. Yeah, but and Ric Flair said he wants to go to Survivor Series, sit in the front row, and see Charlotte win. I don't know, the whole thing's like a big publicity, you know? It's just funny. What else was popping in New York, Kathy? Anything good?
Lawrence Taylor was there.
Nice.
Sue Young. It was a great time. You know, got to see DDT. Haven't seen him in a while. Ron Simmons.
When
was there, you know.
Oh, cool. Okay. When you saw DDP, did you walk up to him and be like, "It's me. It's me. It's Kathy."
Oh my God, Brady! Seriously, Brady, what is wrong with you tonight?
I'm just trying to fill that air. Our free agents have left us, Kathy. I don't know if they're ever coming back. So. By the way, if you're interested, if you're listening and you're interested, if you're a listener to In the Room and you're interested in being a part of the show, feel free to hit me up. Just send an email to Brady@vocnation.com, and we'll see about getting you on the air, whether as a co-host or as a an interview or whatever the case may be. We're kind of looking for opportunities to expand here. Because our cast is overextended, quite frankly. Kathy, I was telling Stro, like, off air, because for those who haven't seen my social media, so I did this interview with Jimmy Hart when I was out in Las Vegas. And the guy is amazing. I mean, I love Jimmy. He's always been so good to me, so good to Bruce, so instrumental in kind of founding the VOC Nation more than 10 years ago. And it's just funny because, like, Kathy, I could ask him, like, any questions I want, but he's going to have the same scripted answers no matter what you ask him. And it's hilarious.
Mm-hmm.
Yep. That's Jimmy. Good old Jimmy.
I am going to try to talk to Booker T about coming on again, if you don't mind.
I don't mind.
Only because he's planning on doing something with ROW, his organization.
Yeah.
To do a Shelly Martel classic.
Oh, that would be
awesome.
Great.
Wow.
Yeah.
That's awesome.
Because as he said, you know, Shelly made Harlem Heat. So I'm putting it up with him and see if he can come on one night.
I would love that.
Oh,
I would love
great.
It. No,
yeah.
No Stevie Ray, just Booker, right? That guy don't like me.
Did you see where he did an interview and he was talking about how you would handle Steve Austin and if he was WWE?
He was talking about the supermarket thing, and he thought Booker like went from like this megastar to like getting thrown around by. I did see that. And I have no doubt that Stevie would have stood up to him.
He said he would have whipped Austin's ass all over that place.
That's funny.
Mm-hmm.
Well, that's probably part of the reason why Booker went to WWE and Stevie didn't, quite honestly.
Yeah.
Yeah. So 914-338-1885. I thought that was great. Another thing that really jumped out at me, and it's a rumor I keep hearing, and like I just think it's such a great idea. Jeff Hardy wants to bring Willow to WWE, and he keeps talking about it in all these interviews now. So like I feel like it's probably only a matter of time where they wouldn't be letting him talk about it. But Willow in Impact was amazing. I actually like him better than Broken Matt Hardy, to be honest.
Hey, why not?
Yeah.
I'm up for it. Yeah.
Yeah, mm-hmm. Why not? He'd be good at it, you know? Mm-hmm. And yeah, I think it would just be something different, you know? Because I think at some point, like Jeff Hardy is kind of in this class, and I don't know how you guys feel, but I think when you've been around as much as Jeff has, and he's been all around the industry, he's been in every company, and he's wrestled just about everybody. So it's like, it's so tough to come up with something that's fresh and original with somebody like that, you know, who's just been around so much. And I think that that's a great way to kind of get a fresh start in WWE in a way.
Maybe even right out the rest. In the merch shop.
Oh, can you imagine those umbrellas they'll be selling?
Mm-hmm.
Or the crazy like wooden tree mask, you know?
Yeah.
Willa reminds me so much, Kathy, of somebody I used to date in college. It's crazy. Right down to the shrill voice. Like that. Yeah.
Oh my god.
914-338-1885. Yeah, so there's that. And I also heard, I don't know if you guys heard this, but I thought it was kind of funny. So WWE, fans have been asking for so long for WWE to stop being PG. And they've given us like PG-13 or whatever. They've given us little stuff here or there, you know. But by and large, it hasn't been. Well, now there's talk that they're going to make NXT TV-14.
Oh, wow.
Which, wow. It's not R, but it's definitely more mature, you know. I think it could be really good. It's a way to kind of, I mean, I said all along, you know, when you've got brands, the most obvious thing to do is to kind of cater them to different audiences.
Mm-hmm.
You know, obviously Friday night on the SmackDown 8:00, that's your kid's show. That's the way it should be. I mean, that's Friday night. Who's home on Friday night? You know, kids.
Yeah.
TGIF, right? The new mm-hmm. Steve Urkel. So I would do that. I would. And, you know, Raw, I think, probably more like your long-term fans, people that have been watching for years and years, that older demographic that we always talk about, you know? And then if you're talking about trying to get the college kids and a little bit younger, the closer to the 18 and the 18 to 49 demo, to me, NXT makes perfect sense, you know? You give a little more creative freedom to people who are in development, and you allow them to see who takes off. I think it makes sense. I've been saying that for a while.
Oh, yeah. Uh-huh. Absolutely.
What do you think, Stry? I know when you were in WCW for a little bit, they kind of went G.
Uh-huh.
And I remember in particular, they had like, not Right to Censor, what was the other one? Standards and Practices.
Yeah,
you know, and they literally had a group called Standards and Practices on WWE
yes.
television.
Yes.
I'm sure that was Vince Russo. But interesting,
yeah.
You know, and I think part of the reason that WCW suffered at the time so much against WWE was because WWE was like, you know what, we're going to take the handcuffs off and just go for it. They're not going to kick us off the air.
Mm-hmm.
And that's what they did. They just didn't care.
No.
WCW.
Very shrewd move at the time.
A lot of people are saying that's the only reason that they were able to distance themselves in that war.
Mm-hmm.
because of the middle fingers and the cursing and the indecent displays, Kathy, as best I can put it.
Yeah. Yeah, I mean, the timing was impeccable for that, too.
Yeah, for sure. For sure. What did you guys think? I have to ask you, and I don't even know if you heard this, but so Mark Henry did an interview this week, and he mentioned that when he left WWE, Vince McMahon specifically told him, "We'll be back for you in 3 years." I believe it. But
probably
what's he
right.
going to do? He's not wrestling, so what's he going to do?
They probably told Jericho the same thing.
Exactly.
I'm sure they did. And he's got to be coming up on it, right? That was like 18.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah. 19, maybe. Something like that.
Oh, yeah.
One guy who I don't think is going back, it certainly sounds like it, is Moxley. He wrote a lot of stuff in his book, apparently, about not caring for the WWE culture, and specifically Kevin Dunn, who's basically Vince McMahon's right-hand man. So, yeah, I don't see him going back.
Yeah.
At least not wanting to. Maybe they'll make him an offer that blows it out of the water, but I
could see Bryan Danielson going back, too, eventually.
I could, too. Especially if you kind of pair it with, like, a Hall of Fame type run, you know?
Mm-hmm.
You kind of yeah. build that. So, yeah, that's where we are tonight. 914-338-1885 is the number to call in tonight. And like I said, we'll be taking the phone calls after Brian Johnston, the Mecca.
The Mecca.
He'll be joining us very shortly. You might even say imminently. We're waiting for Brian Johnson to get on the air. But I don't know about you guys, but I was really disappointed by the whole Ring of Honor announcement. You know, it's something that caught me off guard. And a lot of people are saying, like, they don't know what the future is for Ring of Honor and stuff like that. But I can tell you there's so much history and so much lineage there. And it's just like, I just think it's a shame to see that kind of go by the wayside. Think of all the names associated with Ring of Honor, you know, think of all the legacy there, how many people made their names. And I know they're not the only company to go away. And obviously, but then I look at it like you've got the big three, obviously, in the U.S., right? I mean, you've got WWE, you got AEW, you got Impact. But other than the indies, there really ain't a whole lot of places to go.
You know, it was a very shrewd move by Tony Khan to sign Jay Lethal.
It was. And very I don't blame shrewd. Jay Lethal either. Like, if they got rid of contracts, you know, here's a guy, he's got a family, you know, this is his living.
And Cornette even said if they get Lethal and the Brisco brothers, my God.
And I'm going to tell you, I've heard from people that the Briscoes were calling around trying to get old pictures and footage. So I'm going to guess that they probably are going to AEW. I don't know that for sure. I haven't confirmed that with anybody, but. I have heard from a couple different people that they were trying to get some different things from different organizations that held their footage and held their pictures and things like that. So it'll be interesting for sure. But yeah, like I don't blame Jay Lethal one bit, you know. I don't even think that mentality exists anymore. Like back when ECW folded and all these guys started showing up in WWE, it's like I think there was almost like a little fan resentment in a way. Like, I don't know what you expect them to do, but if I'm fresh off TV and then suddenly I have an opportunity to wrestle somewhere and actually make some bank at it and make enough to like have health insurance and be able to take care of my family and everything that I need. Yeah. Like, of course, of course. So like, that's what they don't really tell you. But, like, Ring of Honor, they might be around, but, like, by not guaranteeing contracts anymore, they're not doing the guys any favors, in my opinion. Now, I don't know all the details of it, but that's just kind of how I feel about it, you know?
Yeah.
I mean, Stro, yeah, you got to be somewhat familiar with that, just kind of all taken away in a way, you know, and
oh yeah,
not having that alternative.
Yeah, that's why, you know, a lot of us stress to others to save your money, because you never know when a company's going to fold. You know, it could happen drop of a hat.
Even when you think things are good, you know, like you think things are good.
Right.
So, so that's kind of where we are tonight. Like I said, we're waiting on Brian Johnson. As soon as he's ready, we'll be good to go. The number to call in tonight is 914-338-1885, and we will be taking calls on the other side. But right now, actually, we have the Mecca joining us. We have Brian Johnson. Brian, I've seen some promos and stuff that you've done recently, but not a whole lot since the big Ring of Honor announcement. First of all, how are you doing tonight, man?
In light of all the news, I think I'm about as good as I can be. You know, obviously the last couple of weeks have been a big change for a lot of people, but professional wrestlers are survivors, and we'll be okay.
Well, you know, you kind of have adopted the tagline of, like, Mecca versus everybody. It's got to be feeling more like that than ever before, just based on everything. I mean, how is it in that harsh competitive world of independent wrestling?
So I'm really finding out a lot more about it than I think maybe some of my coworkers or colleagues have. I wasn't a big independent darling prior to Ring of Honor. I kind of stayed on my small little local scene, worked the places I worked. And then when opportunity arose to find a niche at Ring of Honor, I went after it full board. So I'm kind of learning and tipping my toes into the waters of the independents. And it's certainly dog eat dog, but that's no different than any other promotion either. You know what I mean? We're all competitors, and pro wrestlers are generally, or should be, or at least the top guys seem to be alpha males. You know what I mean? So these are guys that demand attention, guys that want a showcase. So that in any aspect of life, whether it be pro wrestling or pro sports or hell, I'm sure even Hollywood and things of that nature, when you have alpha males that seek attention, it's going to be dog eat dog, because there's only so much attention you can get.
And kind of like watching Ring of Honor these last couple months, I mean, I feel like you, the Mecca, the entire presentation, I feel like it's kind of something that really stood out in a promotion of up-and-coming guys, largely. How much thought has kind of like gone into developing kind of what you've become since you really kind of left those couple indie companies and really just started focusing on Ring of Honor like that? How much thought has gone into the development of the Mecca?
Well, I think that's a thing. I think people think that the Mecca is this person that I am on Ring of Honor, but it's not. It's who I am every day. Is my birth certificate Mecca Brian Johnson? No, obviously, dumbasses. But the idea of me having this downright unbelievable passion for professional wrestling. I eat, sleep, breathe it is such a cliche, but I can't think of a better way to state it. So how much effort goes into getting to the person in today? Well, 32 years of effort. And I busted my ass to get here. Now, was I always doing, was I always angry and directed as I am now? No, but it takes time to find your focus and find your groove. Am I a late bloomer? Maybe. Yeah, because it took me a while to get here, lots of years. There's guys like Flip Gordon within 3 years was a superstar. You know what I mean? Right? I get I'm not that, right? For sure. But just because I might be a late bloomer, my flower was blooming, or my tree was blooming, whatever the hell the phrase is, at Ring of Honor this last year, better than anybody else's. I don't think that's saying too much. Maybe John Gresham, he probably had a better year than me. But outside of him, if you weren't talking about me at Ring of Honor, you probably weren't watching this year, 2021.
Right.
And to see it be coming to, and I don't want to say an end. I think a lot of people are talking about Ring of Honor like it's never going to happen again. We're putting an end date on their tombstone. It's more of a pause. And I know that's weird for people to understand, but businesses take back steps all the time to take three forward. Am I saying that they're going to come back in April in Madison Square Garden again? No, I'm not stupid, right? But I hate this death toll that we have about the company, because I know that if they're back, it's a place that I'd always love to be. I'm not naive that it might not be the same, but I don't like the death toll sentence that everybody's putting on it.
And I can certainly understand that, because people are kind of making it sound like Ring of Honor, the legacy is dead, and that's not what it is at all. Like you said, it's a pause. If anything, it's the end of the current contracts. You know,
yes.
Everything's going to get reevaluated, and that's essentially what it was. But with that said, like I said, you've done so much to kind of stand out in Ring of Honor. I would have to assume, what do you think? Like, when they come back next year, will they make Brian Johnson a priority, do you think?
Well, I'm not just trying to plug the company, because, shit, we ain't going to be running much more shows. But at this current time, at this date, I'm the number one contender for the Ring of Honor Pure Championship.
Yeah.
And that means more to me than family members. That means more to me than any job, any title that I've ever held, any prestige. I'm dead serious. It's the most important damn thing in my life. So in my eyes, that means I have about 8 weeks till this company has decided to put a pause on. So within the next 8 weeks, I plan on using my number one contendership. And if I get that title shot, and I will, I'm not going to miss. And if this company goes on pause with me as their pure champion, I think their hands kind of forced to keep me around if April does roll into what they're thinking, I would assume.
Have you, I mean, just because I know you're such a student of the game and everything, do you ever look back on just the things that you have accomplished and just kind of get that, like, pinch me feel? Like, is it surreal to you to be out there, or is it just another day at the office at this point?
I haven't accomplished shit yet.
Wow.
I truly believe that. I had one good year when there was no fans to base it on. I think if there was critics of mine, they can get bent, but they can stand that point. I think what I've done to wrestling up to this time, while 10-year-old me would be amazed, right? 14-year-old me would be amazed, right? 8-year-old me, 5-year-old, whatever. If tomorrow it's the end of my wrestling career, I'm not satisfied. I truly believe I have the ability, and I am one of the best professional wrestlers on the planet. I think people just don't know about me because I'm not good at freaking social media, because I don't prostitute myself up and down a turnpike for shitty bookings. People don't realize it, but I know that the role that I was on at Ring of Honor is going to continue. Is it going to stay at the same speed at all times? No, that's just impossible to do. And until my name starts getting brought up with some of the best in the world, I'm not going to be satisfied. So to me, I've done shit in my career.
You recently released this promo on social media, and it was so well produced, just kind of talking about shooting your shot and talking about your future and everything. All things being the same kind of, well, that's probably the wrong way to put it, but with the future so uncertain, I should say, what do we know about Brian Johnson as far as the future is concerned?
That's a good question, Brady. I don't think a lot of people know a lot about me, and because I don't share, you know, pictures of my dog on social media, or I'm not wishing my opponent a happy birthday, because I'm in this for myself. I'm not in this for them. I think sometimes it's hard for fans to connect or whatever. I don't care. They can connect with this. I really don't care. I think people don't really get me because of that. And So when they see this video and they hear me talking about losing my home, I really believed Ring of Honor was my home. And to kind of push it a little further, like everybody here, they know in their house, like you don't always get along with everybody, right? You pick your friends, not your family, right? But when someone makes fun of your family member, you stand up for them, right? You can pick on them, but others, you know what I mean? And that was my feeling there. Like, I didn't see eye to eye with those guys. I had plenty of problems with the locker room. And I'm not saying that every day was joyous, but in the long run, it kind of was like a family. And it feels like up in smoke, the family's now all just separated. Like, we were a bunch of kids in an orphanage and the orphanage broke up or something. I don't know if that makes sense, but the idea of like, we're all just displaced now and we're all just trying to find a new home. And I don't know where it's going to be because wrestling, you can never tell, right? But if for the time being, I got to be a man on my own, I think Mecca versus everybody has proven to be successful so far. And I like my chances of staying alive till I find another home.
One of the listeners wants to know, and I think this is a great question, referencing you training under Jim Molyneux in old time wrestling. It's kind of where your roots lie, for those who didn't know. What was that experience like, kind of being in that school and that setting early on?
I think so often credibility is based off of name value. If LeBron James walks in the room and tells you someone's a good basketball player, you automatically agree with him. Yet he signed James Jones, he couldn't get minutes in the playoffs on all of his championship teams. However, if Wayne Gretzky did the same thing, you would listen to him on hockey, but he was a terrible coach, right? Jim Mono might not be known by a lot of fans, and there was another trainer there, Ed Atlas. The two of them ran the school at the time. And they may not be known by a lot of people, but if you are listening to this interview or if you've enjoyed any of my work or the work of a few other people they've had their hands on, and it's not my business to tout them to others. This isn't a sales call for them. But I think those guys, if you like any of my work, it's their fingerprints. Jim has treated me like a son to him. And I can't speak higher of it. Were we the pop and circumstance that some of these indies could be? Hell no. We were grit and grind. We were small little engine that could. And it was badass. It was a cool place to learn. Everybody there cared about each other. That family feeling, kind of similar to Ring of Honor feeling at OTW, what was called the OTW Pro Wrestling Club in Williamstown. I think they released, I don't know for sure, but I'm pretty sure they released some episodes on Patreon over the pandemic. I'm not sure if things have continued. I apologize. I don't know. But the guys that were there were always just stand-up individuals, and that comes from the leadership of guys like Jim. Jim just freaking loves wrestling, man, and put his heart and soul, heart literally and soul into it. Jim's he's a quality human in a world where there's not many of them.
Jim is a great guy, by the way. He's still involved in the ECWA, and you know, I get to see him fairly regularly. He talks so glowingly about you and some of the other students. So
thanks, man.
I don't know how much you talk to him, but yeah, no, he does that all the time. One of the things I think, and I noticed, I got to know you more in ECWA, but I think you had a real quick reputation for kind of being really good on the microphone and being really eloquent and I want to say a natural at it. I know you said being the Mecca comes naturally to you. Was being on the microphone just kind of a natural transition for you as well?
Yeah, I'm not uncomfortable. This is going to be a little long-winded answer, but a lot of pro wrestlers of my generation, of this generation, were wrestling fans prior, right? Whereas, like, someone could say maybe Harley Race, I don't know, I'm just using that generation. Some of them might have just been the toughest guy in their neighborhood, and they were the biggest guy in the gym, and then they saw pro wrestling and kind of picked it up, right? Obviously, people loved it. I wasn't using Harley directly, just that generation. Whereas my generation, I feel like 99% of us were fans, right? Wrestling fans are freaking dorks, most of them. Like, they're dorks without like any personality. They can't stand being rejected, and that's why they go there to like live vicariously through these other people that they admire but can never be. Newsflash, you're losers. And then there's select few that aren't and that are normal thinking, But most of them become pro wrestlers, right? So then they get on this microphone and they're these introverted dweebs and they don't know how to speak because they're scared. Thus, why I'm able to just blow past those guys. I realize the stuff that I spew, I believe too. I think a lot of guys get into pro wrestling and think they have to act like they're somebody else. In ways you could say I was doing that when I was number one. I was trying to be this wrestler that I thought everybody wanted to see. And now that I've kind of trimmed that fat of those type things, you know, the number one, the mirror, the robe, the bullshit, I think it's easier to be me than anything else. And when you can find what that is about you that people give a shit about, that's where you start to hit your stride.
Okay. So obviously there's a lot that's kind of uncertain right now, at least in terms of Ring of Honor, but Ring of Honor, no Ring of Honor. What does the future hold for Brian Johnson? What is coming up for 2022 for Brian, for the Mecca?
So obviously the promo where I talked about home was all about getting out and hitting the independents harder than I ever have. Does that mean that I'm not talking to other companies that aren't considered independent? Time will tell. Does that mean that I'm avoiding other companies? No, I'm as open as available as possible. I like to think of 2022 as like the Mecca locomotive tour. I'm going to be rolling everywhere and anywhere I can, trying to bust my ass a little bit harder, you know, in ways. Working at Ring of Honor obviously had its pluses, but it also had its negatives in the sense that, I don't want to say we got complacent, but we understood that way of living. I knew it worked there. Now I'm back in a new jungle almost, so to speak, or a new land where I got to learn what works here and there and in this locker room and that locker room. It's exciting though. It's a challenge again. You know, it took me 14, 13 years to get the Ring of Honor. And if nothing's going to stop me from keeping my name out in the mouths of wrestling fans and wrestling world. I got it here. It took too long for it just to stop like this. No, it's going to keep rolling. It's just a matter of time.
Okay, cool. Cool. And this might come off as a little disjointed, but a listener just sent this question in, and I think it's a great one. So Ring of Honor, obviously, you kind of rose to power, like you said, without all the fans there. How much different would it have been for you had there been all those people in the crowd to kind of react to you? Would it have had an even bigger impact, do you think?
Yeah, I think so. I think the proof's in the pudding. Let's go look at the last three Ring of Honor shows that we had in front of a live crowd since the pandemic. Yeah. Best in the world. Do you think it was a coincidence that Ring of Honor gave me a live microphone to start their first ever pay-per-view back with a live crowd? Or they said, oh, it's Brian freaking Johnson. And did I wrestle XYZ? No, I wrestled the greatest damn tag team to maybe walk planet Earth, the Brisco brothers.
Mm-hmm.
All right, I think I hit a home run there. Yeah. Then we go to Philadelphia night one. Me and EC3 stole the show. If you left night one of Glory by Honor talking about anybody other than me, you weren't at the same show. And then night two, when Mark Brisco, of all people, needed a partner, who was there to lend a helping hand? And that crowd was rocking and rolling. And then we went to, maybe I got my nights mixed up. Oh, no, and then Death Before Dishonor at the Rumble. I was number one and went all the way to the Final Four. And there was people chanting my name from the start to the finish. There was people, whether booing or cheering or chanting or raving, you know what I mean? But the people were talking about the Mecca. I think the proof's in the pudding. Our four shows with a live crowd, I was the N freaking V freaking P. And there's no touching that. So if there was a live crowd for all of them, are you kidding me? Look at the responses that week by week get when I fill in for Quinn McKay, that dweeb, or when I host TV, or when I'm on commentary. People get it. I know I'm not everybody's cup of tea, and I don't give a shit, but they get that when I'm on there, they're going to be entertained because I'm giving them wrestling as raw and as pure as they'll ever see it. No pun intended to the pure division and those bozos.
I mean, you're somebody that I think people know they can respect, you know, that you're somebody that they know they can take seriously, I think is the best way to put it.
Yeah, I think that word respect's weird because, like, a lot of the people that I'm like, I don't want to say, it's not the respect that I want. It's the acknowledgement, but I guess that comes hand in hand to acknowledge someone is to respect them. It's just weird that the people that No, I think you're right. I think you're right. I'll leave it at that. I think you're right about the acknowledgement. It is an acknowledgement. It is a term of respect. I think people are starting to get their eyes on me, whether it's through promos or through matches, because of the way I handle myself. I appreciate they notice that I take myself seriously also. And that kind of comes through in the way they take me. I think that's what I was trying to get to.
Sure. And there's certainly been a lot of buzz. I even mentioned it in the beginning. Brian, if people want to kind of keep tabs with you and everything you've got going on, obviously not necessarily on the Fight app so much anymore or on the different channels on which Ring of Honor was necessarily, or at least not up-to-date content, but where can people kind of keep tabs on you and everything you've got going on?
So my Twitter and my Instagram are exactly the same. BJO_Mecca, MECCA. All of my information, whether it be what I'm doing daily, coming to workouts, promos, promotions I'm going to be working for, shows I have coming up. Also, I don't want to rid Ring of Honor of what they got coming. Like I said, I'm the number one contender for the Ring of Honor Pure Championship at the moment. That's my back pocket. I have a match coming up with John Walters on Ring of Honor television coming up this weekend, which will drop live on our website Monday or on Sinclair Broadcasting near you. I know it's not easy to find it, so just go to the website on Monday. We still have Final Battle, and we have episodes of TV that I know I'll be on moving forward as they get released. I think this ending of Ring of Honor could be one of the biggest for the Mecca. And with that, I also have, and I hate to just ramble about it, but MCW, which is a company obviously one of the bigger ones on the East Coast. I mean, to get enough credit, they've had like 600 plus people again for another show out in Joppa, Maryland. They put on just incredible talent, and shocking to nobody, I'm the MCW Heavyweight Champion, slowly turned into Mecca Championship Wrestling. So if you want to find anything I'm doing, check out Mecca Championship Wrestling. It's unlike a lot of your top indies, but for all the right reasons.
It's definitely a top show. I recommend people check it out. MCW out of Maryland. Brian, thank you so much for the time tonight. It really flew by. Before we let go, I have a huge favor to ask, and I hope it's okay. Just because we don't get the opportunity to get somebody like you on the air very often. I was wondering if we could get you to record what we call a bumper to play on the beginning of the show.
Of course. No problem, my man. It'll probably help you guys out. Get my voice.
I think it will for sure. So the name of the show is In the Room. If you could just tell people who you are and tell them that they're listening to In the Room, we'll have you on your way, man.
Okay. Count me down.
3, 2.
Hey, bozos. It's the MECCA, the Mecca, Brian Johnson, and you're listening to In the Room. So keep your attention here or get bent.
To sign up, it's very simple. Head to premium.vocnation.com or go to patreon.com/vocnation. VOC Nation takes...
All right. Welcome back, ladies and gentlemen. It's In the Room on the VOC Nation Wrestling Network, as well as on all your favorite podcast apps. So be sure to check us out there. Brady Hicks, I've got with me the Maestro. Stro, before we kind of jump back in, what do you got going on this week, man?
Oh, gosh. This Thursday night, WCW Retro, 9 p.m. Eastern Standard Time on VOCNation.com. We'll be discussing building our Fantasy Survivor Series team from past and present.
Yes.
So if you want to call in and build your Survivor Series team, please call in. We'll talk about it. It'll be a lot of fun. And
Sounds like a lot of fun.
Yeah. Yes. I'm so psyched. Oh, my gosh. And then Friday night, midnight Eastern Standard Time, Strozone, Mahara Sci-Fi Show at facebook.com/StroTheMaestro. The feature for this Friday night will be Night of the Comet from the 80s. So please tune in.
Night of the what?
Comet.
Okay, I thought you said comic at first. I was like, that's me.
Strictly improv, right?
Nice. We also are joined by Derek McDonald. Derek, how you doing, brother?
Derek!
We missed you last week. How you doing?
I'm back. It's been a crazy couple of weeks, but I'm here. How's everybody doing?
We're good. We're so glad that you're on with us. So we're going to have fun. Let the fun begin. We actually just had the Mecca Brian Johnson from Ring of Honor. I think it's still safe to say that for a couple more weeks from Ring of Honor. The number one contender for John Gresham's pure title? No, what's it called now? God, I'm such a bad wrestling journalist. John Gresham's title. He's going after that. so it'll be interesting for sure. But so be sure to check out that interview if you missed it with Mecca Brian Johnson. Stro, you mentioned building your own Survivor Series teams, and I think that's such a cool concept. You know, when I was in seventh grade, I was such a nerd. I know it's hard to believe, Derek, but I was such a nerd. I had my notebook, and I wrote out the entire WWE roster, like, using initials so that nobody knew what it was, mostly because I liked the girl next to me, and I didn't want her to know what I was doing. So, and after that, I would kind of, like, I took that roster. This is while I'm in class, supposedly, taking notes. And I started creating teams of four for Survivor Series and the matchups based on the feuds that were going on at the time. Like, and this is exactly what you guys are doing. I think it's amazing.
Oh, so psyched, man. I can't wait.
And I had this friend, Mike Bell, and he knew exactly what the initials were. I didn't even have to tell him. So.
Nice.
Yeah. Okay. Yeah, He's like, what else could KKBW be besides Coco Beware? Sorry, go ahead.
I used to love Survivor Series as a kid.
Me too.
I wish I could go back to older matches being that format again.
Yeah. I especially liked it when it was the teams of four, where it was like, because you had like your main event guy, your mid-carder, and your tag team, you know? I just thought it was great.
Yeah.
Then they got away from it.
They all had cool names.
Yeah.
It's just one.
They all did have cool names, you know. Now it's just like Team Raw, and it's all people that hate each other. The Vipers, and the Visionaries. Yeah. The Dream Team, the Million Dollar Team, the Bolsheviks. No, the Bolsheviks was the tag team. It was I forget. The Foreign Powers or something.
I mean, one year they had, like, Team America against the foreign team. And Team America was, like, Lex Luger, the Steiner Brothers, and for some strange reason, The Undertaker, who had the American flag inside his jacket. And I remember thinking, that's so weird.
They did that on the Go Home Raw because, like, Tatanka got hurt and they needed a replacement.
That's right, yeah.
Yeah. And it was like
Tatanka got taken out by Ludwig Borga.
Yes, Ludwig Borga and the Quebecers. And who was the other one? I don't remember.
Ludwig Borga. Damn it, who's the other guy? I should know this too.
Yoko? Maybe it was Yoko and Ludwig Borga and the Quebecers. That might have been it, yeah.
Was Crush like a Japanese sympathizer by then?
Yes, he was.
Yes.
Yeah. Yeah. Oh, my God. Those were such great times. They really were. man. So 914-338-1885 is the number to call in tonight. Derek, I thought of you this week. We were talking about Mark Henry earlier. He did an interview this week where he said that the last thing Vince McMahon told him on the way out the door was, "We'll be back for you in 3 years." And this is a guy that can't wrestle, and we'll be back for you in 3 years.
That's awesome.
It's
funny because when you hear these stories about Vince and his feelings about AEW, it doesn't seem like he's sweating them very much.
No.
And people, I think fans want him to sweat them more than he is.
I think Tony Khan wants him to sweat on more than anything, you know?
I read an interview with Ric Flair, and he was talking about how AEW brought in CM Punk and Bryan Danielson. And
yeah.
Ric Flair is like, you know, you bring this guy in and you can barely, yeah. you can barely break a million every week. I don't see the point of why you brought him in.
Right.
Which is true. It's kind of true in a way. I know fans get upset when you say that. But in hindsight, what's the point of spending all that money if you're just going to get the same viewership? Then I saw something with CM Punk goes, oh, well, there's no such thing as casual wrestling fans anymore.
Yeah, bull crap.
Like, okay.
Bull crap, there's okay. not.
Whatever you say, guys.
The problem is there aren't casual fans who still watch the current product. That's the problem. You know? Exactly. Casual fans say, oh, yeah, like, I love wrestling and, you know, The Undertaker is my favorite.
Yeah.
Because they don't know that he retired. Yeah, exactly. That's a casual fan.
Rock comes back. Yeah.
I should say, there are no casual fans for AEW. That's probably fair to say.
Yeah. And, you know, I know it's just, I listen to things that they say. And it's mostly Punk and Khan and everybody. Danny Bryan says that Danny Bryan knows him.
He's above it, yeah.
So he's pretty even too. Yeah. But like, I listen to Punk and I listen to Khan and I listen to some of the things JR says, and they kind of remind me of like when I was a kid and I wanted to play basketball with my brother and his friends, and I'd be like jumping and waving my hands like, hey, look at me, and they just didn't care about me.
Right.
It reminds me of that.
Tony Khan in particular, he's gotten so bad recently. He's just like, all he does is, like, he guaranteed that they were going to beat SmackDown on a night when they were on FS1. And then, like, when they didn't win, he tried to skew the numbers to make it sound like they won and went around saying that they won when they didn't. They got beat, and it wasn't even on their network.
And now the new thing is they're not breaking a million. So the new news I've seen from people I know, like, friends of mine love AEW, and I've seen on the internet, well, they changed the time slot on the West Coast so they can't break a million. I'm like, well, if there's always an excuse, why are you trying to make it a war? If you're going to have an excuse, if things don't go your way.
Right. Yeah. I mean, and when they switch to TBS, it's only going to get worse because fans are just more conditioned to watch wrestling on TNT.
Uh-huh.
It's just the way it is.
And he's spending all this money, and like, I'm happy for Jay Lethal. I'm happy Jay Lethal is there. I think Jay Lethal deserves to be on national television. But now they're saying over the next couple months, Kyle O'Reilly's going to be there, and Kevin Owens is going to be there.
That might
people
be.
And Bray Wyatt's going to
And
people are saying Bray Wyatt's going to show up. At some point, your roster is going to – they're going to have as many people on their roster as Vince McMahon has on his roster now with three shows.
Yep, uh-huh. Yep. And they're never going to be able to use them all. And that's the thing. And like, for example, I love Jay Lethal. He's a great guy. He's always been super nice to me and anything that I've ever had to deal with him. And I understand that Ring of Honor went away and he needs somewhere to go. He needs to pay his health insurance and, you know, take care of his family. I get that. But don't tell me that from AEW side of things, they're going to find a productive way to use Jay Lethal. Not for a second do I believe that.
It looks like he's going to lose to Sammy Guevara tomorrow night.
Yeah.
And I'm pretty sure people will go, and they'll go, well, he looked good in losing. And I get that and I understand that. But, like, all right, two months ago, everybody was telling me that Brian Pillman Jr., he was in a feud with MJF. MJF was cutting these great promos on his aunt and his dad and his mom and blah, blah, blah. What is Brian Pillman Jr. doing today? Nothing.
Mm-hmm.
They broke the guy up for 2 weeks, and they've done nothing with him.
You know what he's doing today? He's going on social media complaining that his phone got stolen and that he lost all his contacts. That's what he's doing. That's why he's in the news. I God bless him, man. I hope he finds that phone, seriously.
Wow.
It's a shame. I have a bold prediction for you, actually. So because the news recently surfaced, or at least the rumor, that WWE is going to take NXT and make it TV-14. Which I think, if you've got a bunch of young, up-and-coming guys and girls, and you're kind of... So many people, this gets lost on them with the brand split, and I think even WWE, it gets lost on them sometimes. when you've got three different brands, it's a great opportunity to kind of position each one towards a different demographic. Friday night, obviously, that's the kids show. That's 8 o'clock on a Friday night. Monday night, that's your show for the traditionalist who's been watching WWE for 30 years and is going to continue to do so just because that's what they've always done. But NXT, that has the real chance, I think, to, and I'm still going to say it, I still think they could overtake AEW at this point. Because if they position that correctly and write it correctly, you don't need major stars. You just need a better concept. You need something different.
And they have, because I'll tune in for a minute, I'll tune in to NXT from time to time. They have the horses. I like to call him Rick Steiner. I mean, Rex Steiner, because I hate
Rex. Rex Steiner is what he should be.
He's a guy you can build on. They have another guy in Carmelo Hayes. You can build with him. They have women that they can build on. Now, a lot of people going, oh, well, it's terrible. Well, they switched it in 2 weeks. It went from what everybody knew what it was, and they completely switched it. And like you said, it's going to take time. But I think they're figuring it out. I think it's good that Ciampa is still there so he can work with the guys. I know Johnny Gargano's contract up, but I can't see Johnny leaving. So I think it's good that you have Ciampa and you know, Gargano there to work with these young guys. I wish Kyle was staying because he can kind of fit in there too. But I like that they're mixing the old with the young. And I saw Kyle Bloom's son was on SmackDown. So I guess they're going to weave him in between shows, which is good because then you get the people who watch SmackDown to get their eyes on these guys and these gals, and then they'll go, okay, I remember him from SmackDown. Let me watch him on Tuesday. It's going to take a while to build that up.
You've also got one of the best, in my opinion, one of the best personas that they developed in probably the last 2 or 3 years in WWE with what Joe Gacy's doing. I think that is going to take off. I think it's going to be when he gets on that main roster, man. He's going to be great.
And what's the Italian guy who acts like he's in the mob? He's hilarious. He's awesome.
Chicago.
They've got things that can work. It's just people are so impatient. But I like it. I like what they did. And if you're going to lose all these guys to AEW anyway, you might as well just rebrand and start building it up from the ground up anyway.
Yeah. Yeah. You know what? I don't think Gargano's going to leave, and I'll tell you why. Because his wife is pregnant. She's under contract. Mm-hmm. They're going to extend her contract because it's essentially the same as when you're out. They're not going to just release her.
No.
So I can't imagine that he would leave and go to AEW and leave her to toil in NXT without him. I can't imagine. I mean, she followed him there.
And there's a lot of people, like, people go, you know, Kevin Owens is friends with this one. And if I'm Kevin Owens, you know, my buddies are there, but you got to think long and hard. Like, the stuff he's doing with Big E, and maybe they're doing this because they know he's leaving, but the stuff he's doing on Raw has been some of the best stuff he's been doing since he was feuding with Roman last year. And you got to think you can make more of an impact staying there than it would be for you to go to AEW and you'd be hot for a month or two and then you're wrestling on Rampage against random wrestler number 3.
Just be the little buddy. Yeah. Stro, I know you're close with Sean Waltman. I know you're or at least you were pretty close with him at one point. I assume you still are. So, like, I, and this could just be the fanboy in me, but I always felt like he had so much more fun in WWF during the Attitude Era than he did in the NWO in 96. I don't know if that's fair to say, but I always thought that he was much more of like a little buddy in WCW. And in WWE, they actually gave him the opportunity to kind of become somebody. I don't know if that's how you perceived it or what he thought.
Mm-hmm. When he switched back with the WWE from WCW, that was when the restructuring of DX was going down. And that really
you go to
him.
Your blood.
Right.
You go to the click.
Right.
Sorry.
And that's what that's what propelled him as a big time star. You know what I mean?
The WWE. Yeah. For sure. That and telling Eric Bischoff he could eat his butt or whatever he said to him.
Yeah. the infamous FedEx. Was that like FedEx that. You got?
Yeah.
Yeah.
I love Adam Cole. Oh, sorry. Sorry about that. That, of course, was tour at the karaoke bar. What were you saying?
I love Adam Cole, and I'm pretty sure AEW fans will tell me they're playing the long game with Adam Cole. But you can't tell me Adam Cole is nowhere near as hot as he was a year ago or 2 years ago at all. He's basically Kenny Omega and the Bucks' little buddy now.
Yeah, he's become the sidekick. Yep. He was his own leader. It makes them look bigger because they could take the leader of, the biggest faction in NXT history and make him their little buddy, but it does nothing for Adam Cole.
It doesn't seem right with him not being a leader, you know what I mean? Because he's just a natural.
Yeah.
I mean, what I would have done? And maybe they could still do it, but I would have Adam Cole be the one to win the title next. Because he's younger, and it makes more sense. And then you could kind of build in dissension with Kenny Omega, which is really where they need to go with it.
Yeah. And like I said, people go, oh, well, Kyle O'Reilly's going to come in, and he's going to join forces with Adam Cole. And that's cool, but this kind of feels like what people accuse Vince of when Vince would bring somebody in from WCW, and he would have to establish his guy over their guy before he pushed the WCW guy.
Yeah.
And it feels like they want Omega to seem inferior to Omega. Omega's our guy. And then eventually, Omega, and then eventually Cole would be risen to that next level. But it's just weird. And then another guy that I'm assuming they're going to bring in is Keith Lee. And
oh, God.
What are you going to do with Keith Lee when he gets there?
If I were Keith Lee, I'd go to Japan.
That's where I would go. And I would just tell him, I'd wrestle in New Japan or Impact or something. I'd go where I'd be the guy, and there's no question I'm the guy.
Yeah.
They haven't been too kind to the big guys. They got it ready,
No, all their giants get misused.
Right, like Brian Cage. Yeah, where's Brian Cage?
Yeah. Archer, I mean, it's bad.
Really hard, yeah.
Yeah,
it still annoys me that FTR hasn't gotten their rematch with the Bucks yet. Like, that still upsets me.
Yeah. Now, I think anybody who really cares about it, that would upset them, sure. What did you guys think with, and again, it's this whole CM Punk thing. Like, he comes in, and I don't get why he isn't the biggest bad guy in the company, because some of the stuff that he says, it's just like, he just comes off as like this unrepentant jerk, like holier than thou. anybody that's ever crossed him was completely wrong. And I realize like that probably eliminates me from ever being able to interview him in a podcast. But I look at him and I see, like, for example, he says to Eddie Kingston, maybe you'd be better wrestling on like AEW Dark than like being on the pay-per-view. And it's like, I get it, trying to get heat, but like, I don't know, man. Why are you going to tear somebody down? Like, that's like one of the first things I learned about a promo. Like, you want to build somebody up, not tear them down. Triple H does the same thing, by the way, and I hate it.
Yeah, it's funny you say that. He's starting to come off a little Triple H-ish. Like, he calls Eddie Kingston fat and lazy and blah, blah, blah.
Yeah.
I'm looking at this, and I'm like, I'm rooting for Eddie.
Like, me too.
Right.
I want Eddie to win.
Yeah.
I guess he's to that fan base, he's their Hulk Hogan. He can't do anything wrong. But I don't know, man. Like, I know people hate Eric Bischoff and they hate on Jim Cornette, but some of the things that they've said about CM Punk have been spot on. spot on.
Right.
He's supposed to be this big savior. He's supposed to be the guy that wasn't around for 7 years.
He's only saving himself.
On Rampage.
Yeah.
Yeah. It's like he feels like, oh, I have to do it to, you know, to prove it to myself. And it's like, what? You're just another guy now.
Right.
After the first night, everything is gone. And the people go, what about Daniel Bryan? Daniel Bryan's different. It seems like he just wants to wrestle. Daniel Bryan just wants to wrestle.
He just wants new opponents, you know?
Uh-huh.
Yeah, that's it. He just wants
that's
to
all wrestle. It is. Yeah.
I understand that.
Punk came in, and after the first night, he instantly became their third biggest signing that week. You know, because, like, Adam Cole and Bryan Danielson are, like, clear and ahead, 1 and 2.
Mm-hmm.
Unless they're in Chicago on the night that Punk debuts.
Yeah.
And even that. What did that translate to? Yeah. What did that get you?
Nothing. And I know people hate Disco Inferno. He has, you know, they always go, what did he ever do?
I love Disco.
He mentioned how they say Punk feuding with Darby Allin was supposed to help Darby Allin. And he was like, you know how you help a guy like Darby Allin in the feud with a guy like Punk?
Yeah.
There's no reason not to like Punk. And then you have him beat Punk so people care about it. Just being in the ring and losing to CM Punk doesn't help him.
No.
Darby Allin got nothing out of that. He got more from the MJF stuff than he got from Punk.
It didn't help Darby Allin. It didn't help Sting, who stood there looking helpless while Punk beat him. it helped nobody. You know, funny story, years ago, two funny stories, actually. So, like, years ago, one of these hosts on VOC Nation, they're doing their show, and I get a text, and she was like, Disco Inferno's on the line, what should I do? And I was like, talk to him, interview, like, what do you mean, what should I do? What do you mean? Why are you doing this, you know? Yeah, she's like, well, I didn't prepare anything. Well, he called you. He's interested. She didn't put him on the air. She didn't put him on the air because she didn't prepare anything with him.
Wow.
And she tried to line him up for, like, 2 weeks later, and he said no. She had him. He called in on his own.
Like,
oh, man.
So, you know, we actually had...
What she was talking about.
It's crazy. That was, yeah. I mean, I can say it was Nanny. I was like, that's crazy, Nanny. Put him on the air. Stro, you know, we actually had Adam Cole call into the show unsolicited before years ago.
Oh, wow.
Yep. He was training at the time. And it was him and Sammy Callahan, actually.
Oh, wow.
Yep.
he's also awesome.
He's
another one. People go, Sammy should go to AEW. If I'm Sammy, he has a good thing going on.
No.
He doesn't have to win every week, and he's still entertaining.
Yeah, and he's got good heat. There's really no. If anything, I think he's got to be building that up, hoping that somebody in WWE takes notice when they start swallowing people up again. But I don't know that they will, but that definitely should be his strategy, for sure. The other story, and this is another great one for old school kind of VOC Nation or In the Room fans. So I got a text on Saturday night during the AEW pay-per-view, Derek. It was from Kevin McElvaney, the editor for PWI now. And he goes, give him the job. I loved it. You remember that?
from Eddie Kingston, he's like, I'm doing an interview.
He did the interview from some parking lot of a strip club. And he's like just hanging out. He's hanging out in the parking lot doing this interview.
Yeah.
And some girl comes up to him and she's like, trying to talk to him. He's like, sweetheart, I'll be right with you. I'm doing an interview. And she grabs the phone from him and yells, give him the job.
Nice.
I love Eddie. Eddie's amazing.
I'm happy for his success.
You know who's not amazing? Now he's amazing too. What's going on, Justin? How you doing, brother?
Hey, what's up, buddy?
You all right? You sound kind of down.
How are you?
I'm good.
No, I'm okay.
You all right? You tired?
I'm all right. Yeah, I'm fine. I just got another 2 weeks to go wearing this leg brace. Then I go to one of the, the bar, like the brace with the bars. I got to go to that one next.
The brace with the bars.
Not looking forward to.
You mean like one of those walkers with the tennis balls on the bottom?
No,
like
it's
that?
Like one of the braces that. It's like one of the braces that Stone Cold Steve Austin used to wear. I got to wear one of those nuts.
Okay. Now, do you get like those crutches that hook to your elbows? Like, can you get one on each side?
I had the ones that you put under your arms and, like,
okay.
I think it was
not like the kind that hook to your elbows, like, okay.
Nah, I didn't have those. But it was it was like two or three days after surgery. I was saying to myself, I was like, I'm not going to use crutches anymore. And I just started bearing weight and just
isn't that bad for your knee though?
The doctor actually wants me to put full weight on my leg so I can
on your surgically repaired knee. I guess you have to at some point.
But I have it.
I got a
brace on it now.
Okay.
At it and all that good stuff.
Now, have you ever hit anybody with the brace? Like, taking it off and hit somebody upside the head?
Nah.
Or use a crutch on somebody? Brian Pillman used to use a crutch all the time. It was great.
I'm not that bad.
He's like, I'm not Brian Pillman.
Not that bad. I would never use my brace or my crutch on anybody. Nah.
You're more like a Technico.
I'm not a Rudo.
You're not a Rudo? Are you a Rudo?
Rudo.
Nah.
Are you like FTR? You're a Rudo?
Nah. I used to be.
Same luchadors?
I used to be.
Yeah.
I used to be a Rudo.
I used to be a jerk,
but I'm actually.
You're more like a tweener now. You're more like a tweener now.
Yeah,
I can get mean and nasty if I'm provoked, but I try not to anymore. But
let me ask you: do you like CM Punk? Do you like CM Punk?
I mean, I've always been a fan of him, and I like him. Give or take.
Do you think he's being a little whiny now?
I mean, he's always been whiny. Like,
so what do you like about him?
Even when I like that he speaks his mind. He speaks his mind, and he's not afraid to express his feelings of where he's coming from. He shoots from the hip.
You know, I had a friend in college, and he was really short, and he used to complain a lot, and they used to say he shot from the hip, right? You know what we used to call him?
Uh-huh.
We called him Little Bitch.
No.
Because he was short, and he bitched all the time. We called him Little Bitch. He didn't like it. He complained about that, too.
I wouldn't either.
Yeah, why not? Why not?
That's crazy.
Yeah, it is crazy. My whole life's crazy. What's that?
I didn't like him. So you know what I didn't like about you in college? He used to call himself the best in the world, and it's like they're in the same company as Brian Danielson, and AJ Styles is still walking this earth. How dare you?
Right.
How dare you think you're the best in the world?
Yeah. And he wasn't He was the most over at a time when he was the only one that was allowed to go on the microphone and say what he wanted without any kind of censorship whatsoever. That's what he was.
Even John Cena
was censored.
I was watching a compilation on YouTube. It was like
there's a $5 word compilation.
I think it was like an hour and a half of CM Punk coming out.
Okay.
Just like trash talking to all the other guys. I'm like that was between 2013 and like during his title run.
Yeah.
How did they not censor the guy?
like, how did they not censor him? It's like, guy would go, like, cursing and going, throwing. The guy would go off the wall, and he still does.
What do you
He's
think?
Crazy. He's crazy.
He is crazy. How cool would it be if CM Punk won the AEW title and then left to go to Ring of Honor only to find out that it wasn't there anymore?
Showed up in the building.
He goes to the armory in Philly and they're all locked up and he's like, what the hell?
And it'll probably be on him. Like, hey, you won the title but you left the company that was employing you, and then you go to a place that's like non-existent and it's like stupid.
It's me, Phil. I have a question. If he would have went to WWE, and this is what people are probably going to get upset. If he went to WWE right now, he's a bigger deal in WWE than he is in AEW, right? Wouldn't he be?
I think he would have. I think he would have. Yeah. I still think he would.
I mean,
I think he would have.
He would have come in bigger. I don't know if he would have stayed just because of the way they book everything now. You know, but
I think
he would have. If they were smart, they would have taken him and put him right on Raw, because then you have Roman on SmackDown and him on Raw.
Right.
And
but he said, I feel like he goes, you know, part of the reason I didn't go back is because if I went, it would have been the same old thing. It wouldn't have been nothing different. Now, I tend to believe Vince didn't offer him the money he wanted, because he wouldn't have sat on the sideline that long if he didn't want to go back, if he wanted to be in AEW.
But, right.
He just said, I didn't want to do the same thing every week. So.
Yeah, and I think the only argument I can see is for fresh opponents.
Mm-hmm.
And WWE is almost a whole different roster than if anything, AEW is closer than the 2014 WWE roster when he left.
Mm-hmm.
Right.
And I think Tony Khan makes guys like him and Jericho feel like, you know, they're a part. Because Jericho talks like it's his company sometimes. Like, he's saying, we should sign this person, and, you know,
yeah,
we're doing this and we're doing that. So I wonder if Tony Khan makes them feel like they're a bigger part of the company than Vince was eventually.
Do you think Vince would – because obviously they did the Stone Cold documentary earlier this year with WrestleMania – you know, not the docu, the interview, the shoot, whatever it's called, with Jericho. Do you think Vince would offer to put Jericho in the Hall of Fame when he's with AEW and kind of steal him back like they did with Ric Flair? I could see them doing that.
I do.
Yeah.
I think Vince was worried at first. And I think now he's seen that the company hasn't really had much growth. And I think he goes, okay. That's why he probably told Mark Henry, we'll be back for you in 3 years.
Yeah.
You know, I think, you know, that's why he tells Christian, we have nothing for you, go ahead. Because I don't think he's worried about them like he was before.
He didn't want Christian to come back anyway. So, like, if Christian's going to go wrestle, at least he's not taking the chance in his company, you know?
Yeah.
That's how I look at it.
Edge, I saw an interview with Edge where he said, you know, when he knew he could wrestle, he had a conversation with Tony Khan, and Tony Khan offered him to come in, and he said, you know, I told Tony, I owe everything to Vince. Vince has been good to me.
Yeah.
I have to go to Vince first. And he went to Vince, and Vince said, sure. But Edge is a star. Edge is a difference maker. So I'd understand him doing that to Edge.
Mm-hmm.
But if Mark Henry comes and goes, hey, I want to go prove myself, you let Mark Henry go. All right, Mark, I'll see you in 3 years, buddy.
Yeah. No, you're right. You're right. Justin, did you have anything else, brother? Now that I let you talk.
I agree with what Derek said about if CM Punk would be a bigger star if he went back to WWE. But I think he would definitely get over with the fans. But just like he said, he wouldn't want to. Him and Vince and Triple H and all that, he doesn't want to go back and work with them, so.
Probably not. But probably not.
I mean,
but I'm fine with that. I actually liked him on the sidelines. I thought he was fine.
Yeah.
Well, I liked him in 2014.
I mean,
I liked him in 2014.
I mean,
but like, you know what bugged me was like, one second. It's like he walked away from a contract, complaining. Most people would cut off their right leg to get a contract like he had, and he walked away complaining. And it's like, I don't know. Like, to me, I don't see how Tony Khan would even bother signing CM Punk to a contract, because if he gets mad, he's just going to leave.
And then he walked out. He walked out the night after the Royal Rumble, right?
Yeah.
That's in January. They didn't fire him for the summertime. That means from January to June, July, you had no communication with your employer.
Until he got married.
When they fired
him. Yeah.
Wow.
Now that was pretty vindictive of Vince.
And they did do that on purpose.
You just left.
Yeah.
Yeah, they did. You left and you didn't say anything for 6 months.
Yeah.
What did you think? You thought they were just gonna wait around for you to come back?
I guess what they could have done was suspended Tatum and suspended his contract. Like, when guys get hurt, you know, I guess they could have done that. That would have been funny, actually, like where his only option is to come back and finish his 2014 contract. But I'll bet you lawyers would have gotten involved, and he would have gotten out of it somehow.
Hey, Brady, but do you think CM Punk would have came back and finished off his contract, or do you think he would have just said, "Hey, I'm done. I'm done. I'm leaving."
I think he would have eventually come back if he had to.
Yeah, he implied that in the Cole Cabana interview. He was kind of implying that I was going to come back eventually. And I'm like, well, when, buddy? You got to let us know.
Yeah.
Right.
And it wasn't about money, but he wanted to be paid like a top star.
I kind of feel that CM Punk he burnt some bridges with WWE.
Yeah, that's a good feeling. Yep. Yeah.
He burnt.
It's very intuitive.
And but it's okay.
It is okay.
Maybe in the future, maybe he would come back.
I don't think they'll ever have him back. Here's the reality. When he came in for that Fox show, when they were doing the backstage thing, if they wanted him, they could have had him then, and they didn't want him. They didn't want to deal with him. That was purely a Fox thing.
They said Fox wanted him.
Okay. Yeah. And I still don't understand why, if you're trying to pump up a product, why you would bring its biggest detractor in, you know? That would be like Joe Buck getting a job for the Philadelphia Eagles. Like, what would be the point? Make him like your new Dave Spadaro, you know?
Yeah.
Like, it's stupid.
Right.
Leave Joe alone. I think it's funny that every fan base thinks Joe hates their team. I do like that. The Giants think he hates the Giants, too.
The truth is, he hates everybody. He's just a front runner. He's a front runner is what he is. He looks at the favored team and trashes the other team.
Yeah.
Hey, Brady, Derek and Shry. I was having you on.
Hey, man. I appreciate you, fam. I appreciate you, fam. Appreciate you, fam. See you, man.
You too, man.
Take care.
Love you, brother. I love you very much.
Love you too, man.
Bye-bye.
Love you more,
buddy. He loves me more. Thank you. He is sweet. He's been humbled by his knee injury, I think. Not 914-338-1885. I wanted to mention, so Bobby Fulton, for those who haven't heard, please keep him in your prayers. He had throat surgery because of cancer. So, I hate to hear stuff like that, but I definitely had to mention it.
Yeah.
Stroh, you got any good Bobby Fulton stories? Sorry.
Oh, man. Bobby Fulton, yeah, I remember one time I was tagging with Iron Sheik against Bobby Fulton.
Sheiky.
And his tag team partner at the time. Bobby, Iron Sheik was telling me to please tell Bobby, I guess he was speaking carny to him, right?
Mm-hmm.
And please tell Bobby that Shiki known as Dan Carney. and Bobby bless his heart, man. He says brother more times than Hulk Hogan, man, when he talks.
Oh, really? That's funny. Yeah.
But
that's funny.
But he's a good dude, man. I mean, God, yeah. I mean,
I've heard nothing bad about him.
Him and Tommy Rogers, man. I mean, they've been like with the best through the years. You know, the Sheep Herders.
Yeah.
Before they were the Bushwhackers, and you know, Midnight Express, and some of the best teams of that time in the 80s. So.
Sorry, I cut you off there, Derek.
Oh, no, I was just going to say, because I haven't spoken to you guys since it happened. The Charlotte Becky stuff. And it seems like you're really dialing it up now, leading into to Survivor Series. It seems like
you're
doing the old Shawn Brett thing. Shawn Brett thing, where he's pitting them against each other.
It's so funny that all this kind of came out right around the time when they figured out that was going to be the Survivor Series match, you know? But apparently they don't talk anymore. Charlotte would have really big balls if she was a man. There's been so many headlines to come out of this. Even Ric Flair's getting involved, and like they don't even want anything to do with him right now. I heard he's going to buy a ticket for the front row.
Poor Rick, he needs a job, man. He's
poor Rick, give him the job.
Yeah.
Man, that's why you never want to be involved in those documentaries. And he didn't even do the documentary.
Oh yeah.
No, yeah, right.
He's at home watching.
He's at home watching with everybody else. Who knew the story and got upset when they heard it retold?
What?
you know, I actually, we were talking earlier, Gerald Brisco, in a conversation with Earl Hebner. I guess they had him on that. Because, you know, Gerald Brisco, he does that show with JBL, that podcast.
Oh, yeah, yeah.
Yeah. So he said to Earl Hebner, is Bret Hart going to pay your mortgage? And I thought that was tremendous.
Yeah, you're not lying. Tell him the truth.
Yeah.
But I love the stories about Gerald Brisco. Like the stories that he was teaching Sean how to be a shooter. Like,
yeah.
Brett went in the ring and Brett decided he didn't want to.
Yeah. I could just see that. Let's go out to Trenton, and we'll talk to Rat Boy. What's going on, Rat Boy?
Oh, boy. I just got good news and some bad news, and it's a spoiler alert.
Okay. Hold on.
Okay.
Hold on, I got it queued up. Wait. Sorry, it's taking long. Bad news, Rat Boy.
Last night, okay,
mm-hmm.
on Raw, okay, mm-hmm. what happened was that the general manager mentioned you got to watch out for Lesnar, right?
Mm-hmm.
But somebody else is going to be there, too. A spoiler alert is going to be Strowman might be coming in this weekend at the Survivor Series.
Where'd you get that?
Well, I heard Brock was going to be at the show.
Because Strowman's coming back.
Is he
going to do the train thing?
Roman Reigns.
Is he going to do the train thing again?
Huh?
Oh, I hate it.
I'm not sure.
Where they played the train music and he ran around the ring?
Already, okay? That would be a good match, okay? Lesnar, Roman Reigns, and Strowman. A triple threat match.
Didn't we see that already?
You remember what happened last time Brock was in the ring with Braun Strowman and Braun was like being stiff with Brock, so Brock had to punch him in the face?
Yeah. That was Saudi Arabia, wasn't it?
Yeah,
oh, yeah.
Good old Brock.
Strowman's going to show up this weekend. Strowman's going to show up.
Okay.
I think the next opponent
for Roman Reigns is going to be Xavier Woods, which I'm okay with because he kind of earned, he's worked hard enough. He deserves that spot for a little bit. So that's why I think Roman's next opponent is going to be right there.
King Woods.
I have enjoyed him as king. He's been a good king.
Yeah, he's been funny.
He's been a very no.
I love that he calls.
Yeah.
He calls Jimmy Uso James Uso. I like.
Yes. And you know what? The king and the queen both consulted with Booker T, which I really like, for ideas, for royalty. Like Zelina's doing like that fake British accent.
Yeah.
Which is like amazing. And then you got Xavier, yeah.
Remember when Booker was doing the accent, and you know, he's doing the kingly accent, and Primetime came and they stole his wallet, and he realized they stole his wallet. And
yeah.
Old Booker, he's like, oh, hell no, where did it go?
yeah. He was a great king. Very majestic. Go ahead, Rabbi.
And I think I'm right about this, about when WrestleMania comes around.
Mm-hmm.
A triple threat match against all three New Day players for the Raw Championship belt.
Wow.
How many times do I have to tell you people they don't want to fight each other? I feel like they say that every month.
It's usually me telling you.
That's what the fans want. That's what the fans want. All three in the ring at the same time. The best of the New Day.
Did you hear?
The best of the New Day right now.
Enough of that silliness. Did you hear, like, the real rumored main event for WrestleMania? It's exactly what I knew they were going to say, but I'm so disappointed.
I did.
Yeah. Stro, did you hear it?
You're right.
No, I haven't.
Yeah, so nothing happened, as usual. So planned WrestleMania main event, their biggest names that they can come up with for night two, Roman Reigns, Brock Lesnar, and Drew McIntyre in a triple threat match.
Wow, really?
I feel like that's been done so many different ways.
Oh, wow.
I would have rather had straight up Drew and Roman, honestly.
Yeah. As well.
I can't stand how everything's triple threat now.
Yeah.
It's like they always got to do it, and I hate it.
Who is maybe they're listening to me on your show? Oh, we're going to make this into a threat match.
Probably not.
Did I say something before about WrestleMania, and they made that match for WrestleMania?
You didn't say they were going to fight each other.
No.
But I need somebody to explain to me. Either Brock doesn't like Bobby Lashley, or some, why aren't they doing that match?
I thought they were close.
Not like the other
yeah.
Person.
Yeah, I thought they were like good friends. I don't know why they're not doing it. And the time to do it was like last year, not even this year.
Right?
Exactly. Yeah, it's one of the few fresh matches they have left, and they just refuse to do it.
They do Goldberg, which doesn't, and then they have Goldberg beat Lashley. Like, I don't know. That just didn't make sense to me. Field Lashley, have him fight Lesnar. Yeah, you're right. That sucked. That sucked.
I don't get it. Now he's destroying the Mysterio family every week.
And it's that time of year, you know, what is it? Are we having a big party next week right here on the VOC Nation celebrate Thanksgiving?
Have some sweet potato pie?
Hey, that's a good one. The sweet potato pie versus...
Have a good night,
yeah.
Versus the finger-licking good chicken.
I was going to say, can I get a finger-licking good?
The finger-licking good.
I love you, brother.
I love you all.
Oh, Rat Boy, what
care, you doing? Rat Boy, all have a happy Thanksgiving. We got potato pie.
90.
We better talk to you next week. What did you think about my interview with Jimmy Hart?
I didn't hear, but I saw a picture. I said, "Wow, okay. You met Jimmy Hart again."
Yep. He's great as always.
That's okay.
All right, baby. I'll talk to you later on now.
Hey, baby. I'm too old. Hey, baby. Baby.
I'm going to cut you off now, baby. We're going to run.
I'm too old, but I sure got the point.
I love you, rat boy.
60 seconds.
I need a one-on-one talk to Jimmy Hart.
I wouldn't do that.
One-on-one.
I wouldn't do that to him. I love you, rat boy. Have a good one. Keep on dancing, baby.
Oh, have a good one.
It's funny. With Jimmy Hart, Derek, I don't know if you saw it, but yeah, because I was out in Las Vegas for like my shoot job, you know, and I'm interviewing people at this tech conference, and then of course the voice of choice, Bruce Word, he's very involved in that sector as well. So he had Jimmy Hart at the booth, signing autographs and taking pictures with all these people. So of course I had to interview Jimmy. And the great thing about Jimmy Hart is, like, no matter what questions you ask him, he still has his script that he runs through. He doesn't answer your questions. He just kind of says what he wants to say. Because he's terrified of offending WWE.
I can understand that in a way.
Well, yeah, guy's a legend, you know? He knows, and you may not agree with it, but like whenever Hulk Hogan's on Raw, you know who's right there with him,
yeah,
baby. Every time.
He's there.
He might have nothing to do with any of it, you know, and he's there. he ain't gonna mess that up. Yeah. Like when
I am mad at you, Jimmy. Get that check.
Like when like when it was Hulk Hogan and Ric Flair, and they were doing the Saudi Arabia thing. The two of them face to face, and who's in the background? Good old Jimmy Hart, baby.
I remember they had the birthday party for Hulk, and all the legends were in the ring, and Brock comes out,
and Jimmy.
Brock staring at Hogan, and there's Jimmy right behind Hogan with the megaphone, looking at Brock. Like, hey.
Yeah. And you just know that Jimmy didn't get the format before he went out there. They just told him to just stay out of the way. should I try it? She won't answer. Oh my God. Forget it, Tora. I gave her three chances. And she has the nerve to hit that little button that says "Talk to me, please." Yeah, so that's where we are tonight. I'm trying to think, is there anything else? Yeah, I don't think so. Survivor Series is coming up. Oh, I did want to mention the Moxley thing, because that kind of broke after. I know that there are some people who like, and a very few. I honestly think that the world is becoming like gradually more and more accepting. Or maybe it's just like the area of the country that I live in, but like when Moxley pulled out to enter like drug or alcohol treatment, like I was surprised by how much everybody was like, you know what, like good for him, unfriend me if you don't agree.
Mm-hmm.
Which is like my favorite phrase now. Block me if you disagree. You know, but nobody did that. You know, nobody really trashed Moxley for that, and I think it's good, because that's the culture that we need to create, especially in like a troubled thing like wrestling. You know, where there's so many demons out there. I thought it was really cool.
Yeah, especially in wrestling, where if this was, you know, 20, 30 years ago, he probably doesn't get help. He just fights those demons because you got to make the next town.
Yeah.
So, I thought it was, you know, I thought it was great that he went to get the help. And it sounds like he's doing well. You know, he has a new baby at home and a wife. And, you know, I'm just glad the guy's doing all right.
For sure. So I thought that was a really good thing. Yeah, I think that's about it, though. Nothing else major. Oh, this was fun. This could be a fun one to kind of go out on. It's a fun Vince McMahon story. It comes from Kurt Angle. And I love me a good Vince McMahon story. He was talking about when Vince was brought Mike Tyson in. And he said, Angle said that Vince wanted to box Mike Tyson. Like, he wanted to spar with him. Because Vince wanted to, because obviously Vince doesn't do anything that he wouldn't, like, Vince doesn't ask anyone to do anything that he wouldn't do himself. So he wanted to know what it would feel like. Did you hear this? To get knocked out by Mike Tyson. This is what Vince wanted to do.
Oh, wow.
That's what he said. That's what Angle said. Vince wanted to box him because he wanted to know what it felt like to get knocked out before he asked anyone else to do it.
Yeah. You know what?
Didn't happen.
You say a lot of things about Vince, boy.
Yeah.
He's a crazy son of a bitch.
He really is. Oh. He's nuts. Remember when he fell off that cage and, like, he, like, broke his arm or whatever? Like, whatever. Well, what did he break? I forget. He broke something. Shoulder?
Looked like, yeah, he, like, fell on, like,
the table.
End of the table. Looked like he broke his back.
Yeah. I mean, it was like that classic story of, like, in the early 90s when, like, they went to the strip club and everybody was doing their finishes on Vince.
Oh, yeah.
You know,
yeah.
I never heard. They were talking about how the steroid trial. I think Matt told this story. And during the steroid trial, they had Alpha and Sinker sitting in the crowd, and they were making faces at the jury, trying to scare them while the trial was going on. I love the relationship between Vince and that family. It's like it's always something crazy. I see.
That's funny. That's really funny. Surprised they didn't mention that during the documentary.
Yeah, it's funny. Yeah, there's a lot of Vince and Alpha and Sink. Jim Cornette also mentioned that when Vince would go partying in the 70s and early 80s, he'd take Alpha and Sink to be his bodyguards in the club in case anybody got out of hand.
I have heard that. Yeah, I have heard that. All right. So I think that's about it for this week. Derek, did you have anything you wanted to plug on the way out?
No, glad to be back. It's been a hectic couple of weeks around my house. As a matter of fact, my son just reminded me, apparently we're going to Survivor Series on Sunday. I have no recollection of that.
Okay.
Apparently we're going.
Where is it at all MSG? Right.
It's in Brooklyn.
Brooklyn, okay.
So, I know the build-up has been pretty terrible, but on paper there's some great matches. So you'll get Shinsuke and you'll get Damian Priest, and you'll get Biggie and Roman. So there's some good matches to be had, but I completely forgot that show is this weekend.
You think there's a chance that Rock shows up?
Oh, I hope so.
That Me too.
If The Rock shows up, then I'll have no complaints.
Because I'm just thinking, like, it seems like he's been protesting a little bit too much recently. And that just reeks of, like, hey, we want to, like, throw people off.
Yeah, and this month is apparently it's because I saw a picture of Damian Priest dressed as The Rock and Matt Riddle dressed as Rocky Maivia. So apparently this week is a Rock Appreciation Month. So
25 years.
Back. I don't know.
Yeah, no, that's amazing. That's good stuff. Well, Derek, it was great to have you back. I'm not sure what's happening with the new guys. They signed a temporary contract, and apparently we let it lapse. Mm. Our legal department let it lapse, so they're they have the new offer, but they took it home. Yeah, I don't think it's looking good. So we'll see. We'll see. But we'll be okay. So it was good to have you back. Stro, did you have anything that Yeah, for sure.
With Thursday.
What do you got going on? Yep.
Okay, with Thursday, WCW Retro, 9 p.m. Eastern Standard Time on VOCNation.com, 9 o'clock. we'll be discussing creating our own Survivor Series team, past and present. So if you'd like to call in and create your own Survivor Series team, please tune in. It should be a lot of fun. And Friday night on the Horror Sci-Fi Show, The Stro Zone, midnight Eastern Standard Time at facebook.com/StroTheMaestro. The feature for Friday night will be Night of the Comet for the 80s. So please tune in.
All right, very cool. Thank you to everybody for tuning in to In the Room this week right here on the VOC Nation Radio Network. Be sure to check out all the great content that's available, both on demand as well as live. Go to VOCNation.com and check us out on your favorite podcast platforms. Thank you to the Mecca, Brian Johnson, for the time tonight. It was really great. It was good to catch up with him as well. And be on the lookout for everything that he's got going on, because I think of all the stars of Ring of Honor, I think he's somebody that really is going to be taken off in the near future. So be sure to check out the Mecca, Brian Johnson. That's about it for me. I'm off from wrestling shows until next year sometime. So, yeah, that's about it. Everybody, take care of each other. Be good. We'll talk to you real soon. Love you all. Bye-bye.